Well, my name is Joseph Hodge, and I am the producing artistic director of Playmakers Repertory Company.
The particular challenges of approaching Shakespeare as a director is that you're dealing with you know, it's an English language text, but it's also 400 years old. And even in Shakespeare's time, it's not like people went around speaking in iambic pentameter. It was heightened language in Shakespeare's time. It remains heightened language in our own time. There are formal demands that the play requires, and all of the emotional, all the psychological, all the underpinnings, as if you were working on Death of a Salesman. So, and the marriage of those things, I mean, you know, a well-spoken, oh, it sounds like poetry aloud production is deadly of Shakespeare. And a mumbly, deeply felt, but nobody understands the words production of Shakespeare is also a disaster.
All things in common nature should bring forth without sweat or endeavor.
You know, typically, on most shows, of course, you have one director, and you have a set designer, a costume designer, a lighting designer. Directors don't normally collaborate in this way. Designers don't normally collaborate. I mean, they collaborate with one another. Oh, you're doing the costumes, I'm doing the lights. We should make sure our color palette, the choices we're making, speak to one another in an appropriate way. The design process began with Dominique and I spending a great deal of time describing these plays to one another and what it is that we wanted to pursue. And then we started talking to the designers. You know, I think people often think that a conversation with a designer, a director's conversation with designers about, you know, where do we put the sofa? But they're not those conversations. They're conversations finally that are just about the play. And we keep talking about the plays and which themes resonate. And in great designers, those themes will begin to emerge as visual ideas of what that room wants to look like. What the clothes want to look like. You know, The Tempest has so much magic in it, so there's the temptation of loading it up with you know, stuff. A very decorative production. It's not what we're interested in. We're interested in a sort of magic where you can see the strings that's happening in the room. This idea of the sea and a sand-blasted, salt-blasted scenery, a scenic world. It's almost an alabaster. The idea of doing The Tempest around a pool of water, a play that clearly has the sea in its ears, is of course incredibly thrilling. And it's, you know, it multiplies all your problems. Oh, that's a beautiful costume. And they say, well, what does it look like when it's wet? Oh, it looks terrible when it's wet. Or it looks great, but it weighs 160 pounds and the actor can't move in it any longer. I was a disaffected teenager growing up in Miami. I didn't like it. I didn't want to do it. Like, everything bored me. Everything seemed stupid. And, you know, my senior year in high school, very literally, we had to do a monologue. So I went and found one, and I did. And I remember my high school teacher crying and saying, you know, she was touched by that. And the idea that I could take all of that teenage disaffection and rage and frustration and loneliness and finding a place to place all of that in a way that wasn't destructive and that wasn't in a way that was positive and in a way that could affect other people was a really big, it was such a big experience for me. There's a Jungian reading of The Tempest where you could read Caliban and Ariel as not separate from Prospero himself. And there's a part of the play that accepts this idea of reconciling our darkest parts with the rest of us.
I'm McKay Koble, and I am the co-designer with Jan Chambers, doing both sets and costumes.
I'm Jan Chambers, I'm the second one.
I've always loved making things. My favorite toy as a kid was something called Super City. Snap together walls. It was very Frank Lloyd Wright, and you could make buildings. And I just loved reconfiguring space.
Yeah, going into these imaginal worlds and never having it be the same.
Mm-hmm.
I am never bored.
All of us, I think, have a real similar way of approaching work.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And again, it's very visually.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. McKay and I both just started compiling folders full of digital images that we shared with each other and that we shared with the directors, with Jade.
when you look at the set now, you can find little bits and pieces of even that very early research. And what's interesting about Jan and I is we hit on many images
that were the very same.
This is such a different challenge, you know? Two different directors working with Jan and Jade, even though we know each other and we think a great deal alike. The work is monumental. I always start with the givens. Tempest on its own doesn't have a lot of givens in terms of the set. I mean, that was sort of the beauty of those kind of productions. They didn't require a lot, and I think a really well-made play doesn't require a lot. The fact that one of the givens was we wanted a giant pool on stage, I think colored everything from the beginning.
I tell my students, read it first for familiarity, and then you read it for the givens. And then I also have them go back and read it again for the sensory experience of the world.
Dominique's first, the first day we met him, he handed me a picture of a cement slab hanging from the air. He said, this is how I feel about the world. So he gives us stuff. We do sketches. We show them to the directors.
I think you learn an awful lot about the way your set is going to go together by actually putting your model together.
Would you like a window?
what about a ceiling piece? Right. And so you have all these things, and that's really the way I start working. Yeah. You know, I'll use clay, whatever I've got, spools of thread. So you get to take your person and look at the world if you were this big.
Well, in a way, it was kind of full circle in that the first thing that Dominique showed us was, you know, very cold, very hard, but very neutral, which is cement.
A lot of our imagery headed in that direction, abandoned places, abandoned pools, and what happens when nature kind of comes in and takes over.
The point is he's alone with his thoughts and his daughter and these two inhabitants of the island. For us, we've given him a place. You'd have to do a lot of thinking if you lived in this space.
To see this in that scale.
Yeah. It looks just like this.
Oh, it's amazing.
That's always fun when you look at the model and you're like,
I'm Jade Battine. I'm the associate costume designer for this production.
Most of the stuff that we are using for Tempest is completely made from scratch. Because they're not really the sorts of things you can go to the store and buy stuff like this.
The drapers are the ones who interpret the drawing. If it's something that's going to be made, we talk with them beforehand about how we see the costume moving, what it needs to do, if it's going to get wet, all those kind of things. So the first time we fit them, they're in mock-up fabrics because you don't want to cut into some of the really nice fabrics that we've chosen for these, particularly like the court doublets are very, very lavish, rich fabrics. And then they take all the comments and the muslin back into the workroom and then they translate those into patterns and cut them in the real fabric. And what we're looking at these weeks as we go into tech, we're looking at nearly finished garments. It's always thrilling. You know, I'm 110 years old and it's still thrilling to see the costumes when they come.
And it's always great when the actor gets those clothes and they just become that guy. Right. Like, you know, they put on that doublet and there they are. I always feel like I've done my job well.
We're very fortunate to have Michael Meyer from North Carolina School of the Arts working with us on this design. This is the sketch that he's working from. He's built prosthetic pieces for the chin and for the forehead and brow, and then there's a skull cap that has like scabs and barnacles and whatever. Then that has to transition into what his body actually looks like. So again, covered with crustiness.
This is a cast of a spine. We'll use this to help hide where the zipper has to go into the bodysuit, because the net that they're using is so fine that once it's stretched over the skin, the hope is that it disappears entirely.
So this is what Ariel's head started looking like. We've deviated from that a little bit, we've simplified it. She too has a bodysuit on. They want her to sort of blend in with the set. I think we go into rehearsal with a lot of questions that need to be answered in rehearsal. So we're all kind of waiting with bated breath.
We learned mercifully in time before we actually made the costumes for Stefano and Trinculo, they were going in fully submerged.
It's actually much easier to slide in there once they're covered.
And are they, have you dunked them in water to make sure that they're completely waterproof?
I've done a lot of testing, and I did samples, and yeah, they're waterproof.
That's pretty amazing.
Yeah, it's exciting that she can go in the water and it's not going to be a problem. It's all waterproof, and we have all these pockets so that you can take the fat pads out, and then wardrobe can wash this piece separately. So
this is part of the jacket for Kathy Williams, who's playing Alonzo. Since she is of high rank at the court, she gets one of the most opulent pieces. And so we have this lovely patterned corduroy. In addition to that, they're putting dimension on it by adding this sort of Art Nouveau-ish lace that has been gilded with gold.
And it's really quite exciting to hark back and think when you were thinking, what should Ariel look like? And then to actually get to see that.
We still have surprises coming down the road.
Oh, yeah.
And you just have to be along for the ride.
Even when it gets really hard, it's joyous because you're creating something.
Picker.
I'm Emma Nadeau.
Before it was Ari and Emma from Lost in the Trees, it was a concept, it was an idea that we wanted live musicians in the room and that we wanted something that felt very much company held.
Composing something that's evolving in front of you with live people and constantly changing versus something that's set to picture is different.
When it works well, it is a give and take. You know, there's a certain amount of work you have to do on your own to get your idea kind of solid, and then once the idea is solid, you mold it. That's the part, I think, that's collaborative.
The music's beautiful. It's being composed. It's very otherworldly, and very, yet at the same time, it's coming from human voices, so it's quite remarkable.
The trick is to find what the emotion is of the scene and what the function of the music is. And then it's how to fit it to the scene. So how does it come in? How does it leave? Are you just accenting certain things? Is it an underscore?
We have to make sure that it, you know, that it doesn't cloud it up.
It's successful if it enhances what's already there. Or maybe tells you something that is unspoken.
Awake,
it should be this like graceful thing that kind of comes up from behind the scene and then comes back away and you didn't even notice.
One thing that we figured out with the Tempest is like the magic, literally the magic in the play, the charms and tricks and things that happen. You know, those are moments that we chose to elevate with music. That was a nice like realization. You know, we could literally go through the script or watch the scene and say, this is when so-and-so is being charmed. Like, this needs an otherworldliness to it, and the music can provide that.
I just respond to the Shakespeare because there's an elegance to it. It's just so well done that I feel like I'm learning from it, or you know, it's almost easier to put music underneath it because it stands so well on its own, and it's providing, it knows what it wants.
I'm Julie Fischel, and I play in the production of The Tempest. I play Prospero. But, you know, the thing I think that's great about the theater is that it's a place where we can go and we can participate in the telling of a story in front of our eyes in real time. And we can see what the repercussions of our actions are without taking them. In the theater, you're having to go back night after night after night, reinvesting yourself in telling a story that your character is living for the first time. And there's a line that says, now, you know, at this hour lies at my mercy all mine enemies. You know, how wonderful is that? I mean, all of us dream of, you know, revenge, or, you know, we've been hurt and we just think, what a gift that is, you know, to our darker sides, if we're honest about it.
It's a born devil on whose nature nurture can never stick.
It's that saying of, like, you know, pointing one finger, and if you look down, you've got three fingers pointed back at you. And so I think that's what happens with Prospero. It's quite a journey. And I like that it's being directed as not easy to forgive. Mm-hmm. Which is the truth about forgiveness and reality. I mean, as human beings, we're not perfect. Life is a struggle, you know. As we worked on it more and more, I really appreciate what they're trying to do with it, which is really make it very accessible and not, you don't recognize Prospero as mythological. He's a man. You know, he's somebody that fell asleep on the job. Mm-hmm. He made a mistake. And that mistake cost him enormously. I mean, it's somebody who wants to control, based on that shame and guilt.
I will plague them all, even to roaring. Come.
I knew I wanted to get into my body in a more forceful, aggressive way. I started kickboxing. It's the best thing I've ever done. I won't even stop it now. I mean, it's part of my life. It's not just for this part. And then, of course, there's the water, which, you know, is everybody's guess as to how this is gonna play itself out. I mean, it's contained, but it's also has a mind of its own.
Wish mine eyes would with themselves shut up my thoughts.
Shakespeare especially gets such a bad rap when you're young. I mean, you just read it and it's just like, ugh. Well, if you really remember that in Shakespeare's day, most people didn't read. I mean, his plays were not to be read. They're to be up on their feet and performed. With one scene I have with Ariel in the first act, where I'm reminding her from what a torment I freed her when she was, you know, shut into a tree for 12 years before I came to the island and helped her get out. Thou best knowest what a torment I did find thee in. Thy groans did make wolves howl and penetrate the breasts of ever angry bears. The way that Shakespeare's describing, like, those howling that this one little spirit is doing inside of a tree can be felt and heard and agitate angry, you know, ever angry bears, bears that never stop doing this. So if you think about what that image is, it's quite phenomenal, actually. We are such stuff as dreams are made on, and our little life is rounded with a sleep.